Welcome to Digging Deeper on Mark 1. This is our first summer Bible study video based on our summer reading plan through the Gospel of Mark. And as the name suggests, I'm really intending this for those of you that want to dig deeper into the summer reading. So that's who I'm targeting. That's what I'm going to try to accomplish, is to hopefully give you some helpful and cool things that help you go a little deeper into Mark. So that's who I'm going for. I'm expecting that to probably be a little bit smaller of a group, and I'm great with that. And what we'll do each week is I'm just going to kind of point out a few things based on that week's reading that stood out to me and that I just want to kind of take you a little deeper into. If you have any questions on things that you're reading, feel free to send those to me or to a resident, or comment it or DM it on our Instagram, whatever you want to do to get it to us. For those of you that are reading through Mark in the summer, we might even do a Q&A at some point, try to answer some of your questions once we get going a little more. So I just want to point out three things in Mark 1, and hopefully this helps you as you read through Mark 1. You may have already seen some of these things. Depending on where you are in the reading, you may read them later in the week, but these are all in Mark 1. Now, before I go through those three things, I want to start with this just to give you a little background on the Gospel of Mark, to kind of know what you're going to be going through this summer. I want you to think about this. If you are caught in a storm, what's the first thing that you're going to do? Well, most likely, one of the first things that anyone's going to do if they get caught in a storm is they're going to look for a shelter. They're going to look for safety. That's going to be their first concern. They're not going to be thinking about, oh, where am I going to eat tonight? Or, oh man, I really want the new iPhone. That's not going to be on their mind. On their mind is going to be, I need to get to safety. Now, why do I say that? Because Mark is writing this in the context of a storm. What do I mean by that? He was writing this to Romans, not too long after Jesus had died and risen and then gone back up to heaven. So he's writing this to people in Rome who were being persecuted for their beliefs in Jesus. They were suffering because they were Christians, and things were crazy at that time. So most likely what would have been happening if you were in their shoes is you would have been asking questions like, is Christianity even going to survive? You've been asking questions like, is this worth it? Like, can we actually trust the things that we believe? Now, additionally, there have been a lot of people that weren't Christians. So Mark would have written this for them as well. So one, to strengthen Christians who would have been in a crazy storm, and to really talk to people who weren't Christians to attempt to show them who Jesus was. And really for those that were in the storm, if they could see that, yes, you can trust who Jesus is, you can trust that this is reliable, you can trust that it's worth it, that would have given them strength and safety in the midst of the storm. That's what Mark's after. Okay, so look at verse 1. If you have your Bibles, I would encourage you to have your Bibles when we do this. Okay, look at this. This is the first three verses of Mark's gospel. He is writing this to mainly those Christians in Rome. Okay, so let's look at this. This is the first three verses. This is the first thing that stood out to me as I read this. Okay, it says, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Okay, so what's happening there? Well, I don't know if you've ever seen a movie that gets off to a crazy slow start and you're just really bored and you're like, man, is this ever going to get good? I thought this was going to be a really good movie and it's just boring from the beginning, right? That is not what Mark is doing. Mark is starting strong from the get-go. He is going fast-paced from the get-go. And this is what I mean when I say that. What he's saying right from the beginning, right from the first three verses, he's putting everything on the table. He's saying, hey, this is what I'm about from the get-go. And there's two huge claims that he makes right from the beginning based on those verses. He starts by saying, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Okay, so that term Christ, Christos, that would have meant an anointed royal figure. This is the Messiah that God's people were expecting, that he would rescue them and he would reign over them as king, and he would administer justice and peace. So that's someone that they were waiting for. So that's the first thing that Mark says, hey, Jesus is that Messiah figure. But he doesn't stop there. He says he's also the Son of God. That's a huge thing to say. So he's saying Jesus is not only this long-awaited Messiah, he is the Son of God, meaning that's a claim of divinity. This king that we've been waiting for, this Messiah. He's also God himself. And by quoting that Isaiah passage, he's taking the stakes even higher. And he's saying, hey, this Jesus, yeah, he's the Messiah. He's equal to God. He's the Son of God. Okay, this is the one that we've been talking about from the prophets. This is the one that we've been expecting. This is a huge claim that this God is also the king that came to rescue and save his people. This is a huge thing to say. His audience from the get-go would have been like, whoa, he did not ease into it. That is a bold way to start. Okay, now this is the point for us, is that this is not just a biography. This is, Mark is making an argument. He's not just saying, hey, here's some facts about who Jesus is. He's saying, I'm going to tell you selective things about Jesus' life to make a point, to show you who he is. And specifically what he's trying to do is he's trying to tell us about Jesus' identity, who he is, and his purpose, why he came. So the first half of Mark, the first 8 chapters, he's largely going to focus on trying to show us that Jesus is the king, he's God, and he has authority over all things. He has power over all things. In the second half, chapters 9 through 16, he's largely going to show us Jesus' purpose, that this king, this God came to lay down his life in humility, to become a servant, to die on a cross. Okay, that's incredible. And really what he's going to show us is the more and more we understand this, the more and more we understand Jesus' identity and purpose, the more and more we're going to understand our own. Because everyone wants identity. Everyone wants purpose. Who am I? Am I an athlete? Am I a good student? Am I someone who's really cool? Am I someone who's really successful? And Mark's saying, no. Your identity, who you are, is found in a relationship with Jesus. He's going to talk about that. He said, and what's your purpose? Is it to make money, to be really successful, to be cool, to prove yourself? What's your purpose? He says, no, your purpose is actually found in following Jesus. Okay, so that's the first thing. Now, the second thing is this. This is in Mark 1, verses 14, is where we're going to start. Okay, so check this out. After John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. Right, so one of the books that I'm reading right now to kind of help me with Mark is by Tim Keller. It's called Jesus the King. Highly recommend it. And this is really the thing that he says about those verses. Okay, a lot of people misunderstand what Christianity is all about. A lot of people think Christianity is about good behavior and good advice and following rules. And that's not at all what Jesus is saying. When he says he came to proclaim the gospel, this word means good news. So what Jesus came to proclaim is not good advice. It's not good behavior. It's not a good political idea. It's not good rules. It's not just good ideas. It's good news. And what that really means is it is something that has happened in history that changes your status forever. That's the good news that we're talking about. It was actually used if a town had won a battle, people would come back and they would give them a gospel. They would give them news that the war had been won, that someone else had accomplished a victory for them. And what Mark is saying is, hey, Jesus' message is one of good news. Now, why does it say that it's the good news of the kingdom? Because the good news is all about the fact that Jesus Christ came to die on a cross for us, and now we submit to him as king. He is the good king. He's the king that brings healing. He's the king that brings hope. But the problem is this: what all of us do in sin is we reject his reign, we reject his rule, and we live for ourselves instead. We lean on our own understanding, and that causes brokenness. In fact, everything falls apart when that happens. And all you have to do is watch the news right now. Okay, the way that I would say it is this: if you turn on the news, and really in our own lives, it's the same thing, is we experience what I want to call horizontal brokenness. When I say horizontal, okay, horizontal is like this. So that's our relationships with one another. There's so much brokenness in our world right now. And people are throwing out all sorts of solutions based on good behavior, good advice, good political ideas. And I'm not saying those things are bad. But what Mark is going to say is actually based on what Jesus is saying is that the way to fix horizontal brokenness is first to fix vertical brokenness, meaning that the only way that my relationships with others are going to flourish is if my relationship with God is fixed. And Jesus came to do that. He came to fix my relationship with God. So that's the good news. And when I trust him and when I'm walking in a right relationship with God, it's going to overflow into my relationships with others, that when my vertical relationship is right with God because of Jesus, my horizontal relationships can begin to heal and can begin to flourish. That's relevant for us today. We're going to learn more about that. Okay, here's the last thing. This is in Mark 1, verse 16. This is cool. I'm going to kind of end with this. These are going to be like 10 to 15 minutes every time, by the way. So again, we're digging deeper for those of you that want to. Okay, passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and followed him. This is one of my favorite stories in the Bible, and it's in the different Gospels. I go back to this all the time, okay? But this is what's happening. We're going to come back to this later, Mark. But what Jesus is after is disciples. Disciple, the word is mathetes. It means a learner. He is after people that want to learn from him. Okay, so he's not just trying to build a huge crowd that clap for him and make him popular. It's not what he's after. He wants a few disciples to follow him. He's going to train them, and then they're going to go and change the world. That's an amazingly countercultural strategy. Okay, not even a lot of churches are doing that today. We live in a society where Christianity is a lot about building big crowds and big events and a lot of energy. And those things aren't necessarily bad. They have their place. But what Jesus is saying is the bigger priority is building into a few people's lives through relationships, and then they're going to change everything. It's an amazing thing. So these guys had probably heard him before, and now they're being called to radically follow him. And the reason I love this is because this is the essence of being a disciple. Okay, look at this verse. This is verse 17. This is actually the verse that made me want to do Mark this summer with you guys. It says, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." This is daily discipleship. Every single day, the essence of being a disciple of Jesus is following him and then letting him send us out to go and affect and impact the people that he puts in our path. So here's the question I want you to think about today. What does that look like to simply follow him? Those two words, follow me, those powerful, life-changing words. What does that look like for you today? What Mark's saying is that if he is the king, he gets priority over everything else. That's why these guys dropped everything to follow him. That's radical. That's a radical call. Okay, but here's the truth. Every one of us is following something. Every one of us is a disciple of something. Every one of us is being affected by something. It can be what other people are saying. It can be the media. It can be social media. It can be YouTube. It can be anything. And what Mark's saying is, hey, follow him. This is who you want to follow. This is who you want to be formed and shaped and trained and taught by. Okay, so what does that look like for you today? I want you to think about that. What would it look like for you to evaluate the things that you really are following? What would it look like to truly follow Jesus today? Okay, I want to end with this thought, and then we'll be done for the week. Why do we do that? Why would we possibly lay down everything to radically follow him? Okay, this is why. What Mark is saying, and he's going to continue to develop this, is that Jesus has authority and power over everything. He is the king. He is God. And the same Jesus humbled himself out of love to become a servant, to suffer on a cross for you and me, to save us. Saying, when you see that, when you understand that he actually radically gave up everything to come and rescue us, that will just compel our hearts to gladly want to follow him and learn from him. That's what we're going to be about this summer. Okay, so check back in next week. We'll look at the next chapter of Mark, and we'll dig a little deeper. If you have any questions in the meantime, let us know. Mark is awesome. This is going to be a great summer. Hope this helps you go deeper today.